Welcome friends. Now we are going to revise the malpresentations and malpositions in the fetus, and the common are occipital posterior position, breech, transverse line, also called as shoulder presentation, brow and face presentation. Now let's see one by one. Occipital posterior position, most commonly seen in either anthropoid pelvis or android pelvis. The cause is also that the head is little deflexed, and because of that, the occipital posterior position is favored. Disproportion, that is cephalopelvic disproportion, can be another cause, and high inclination of pelvis where there is sacralization of the lumbar vertebra, that can also lead to occipital posterior position. Very important causes of occipital posterior position, MCQ has been asked. Diagnosis, usually there is a sausage-shaped depression on per-abdomen examination. The sensiputal prominence is felt anteriorly. Limbs felt on either side of the midline. And fetal heart, they are moved more towards the flank, towards the backside. On PV examination, when we do, usually there is sausage-shaped membranes, again elongated membrane, bag of membrane. And once it is gone, you can feel the fontanelle. Anterior fontanelle is felt more clearly because of the deflexed, and posterior fontanelle is felt posteriorly. So that confirms that it is occipital posterior position. Now what happens in labor? The most common occipital posterior position is right occipital posterior position. And because the engagement takes place in oblique, the right oblique is more accessible. Left oblique diameter is occupied by the sigmoid colon. So baby chooses the right oblique one, and that favors right occipital posterior position. If there is favorable mechanism, that means when there are good uterine contractions, the pelvis is adequate, either anthropoid types or spacious gynecoid pelvis, then usually 90% of the times there is long anterior rotation. Because you all know that if delivery has to take place, the denominator, that is occiput, it has to come and lie below the pubic symphysis, then only it will get delivered. So in favorable situations, there would be a long anterior rotation through 3/8 of the circle. Shoulders, they were in left oblique because the head was in right oblique. Neck can sustain only 1/8 of the torsion. So shoulders will get rotated through 2/8, and now they will lie in right oblique. I hope you understand. Right occipital posterior, the head is in right oblique, shoulders left oblique because they are perpendicular to each other. Now as neck can sustain only 1/8, shoulders also move and they come and lie in right oblique. The sensiput lies below the pubic symphysis. Then there is crowning, delivery of head with extension, restitution because neck is under tension, the recoil will take place. Restitution is through 1/8 of the circle in the opposite direction of internal rotation. And then the shoulders will go in. Shoulders will become the denominator, the acromion process. And this denominator will get shifted towards the pubic symphysis. And that will be seen as a passive movement of the head, that is external rotation. One more, that is 1/8 of the circle, again in the opposite direction of internal rotation. So this is how the long anterior rotation in favorable position. If the position is, or the situation is unfavorable, then there can be three things that can happen. Either there is short anterior rotation, that means the head rotates only through 1/8 of the circle. The occiput comes anteriorly, but only till 1/8 of the circle. And now the sagittal sutures are in transverse diameter, but they get stuck over there, and this may lead to deep transverse arrest. Now next, what can happen? That if the occiput and sensiput, if they both are touching the levator ani, then none of us will get rotated. Occiput, if it touches, then it levator ani rotates it anteriorly. But if both are getting touched to the levator ani simultaneously, nobody will move, and that will cause oblique arrest. That means the head will remain in that oblique diameter forever. That is called as oblique arrest. Or if there is more deflection, and instead of occiput, if sensiput touches, then sinciput will get rotated towards the pubic symphysis. That will lead that the occiput go posteriorly, and that will lead to direct OP position. Now, what happens in each of them? Either there would be arrest, that is deep transverse or oblique arrest, and in direct OP position, there can be face to pubis delivery possible, that the head goes down, the chin, the root of nose hinges below the pubic symphysis, and there would be delivery of head with flexion. Now, in these arrests, in these conditions, what are we supposed to do? Again, reassess the pelvis. If there is arrest, we can try manual rotation and forceps extraction, or forceps rotation and extraction. Ventus can be applied, or if the baby is of bigger size, or you feel that this baby will not come out through this particular pelvis, then we can always go for caesarean section. As I told you, in direct OP position, spontaneous face to pubic delivery is possible. Now let's have these MCQs. The commonest cause of OP position during labor is, the options are maternal obesity, deflection of head, multiparity, and android pelvis. Now the word during labor is used, so that's why we have two reasons here. Maternal obesity will not cause OP position. Multiparity also doesn't increase the chances. So there are two things. One is deflection of head and android pelvis. We have to select one. Android pelvis is much more valuable because they have mentioned that in labor she is. So till labor, at least deflection should get corrected. But deflection, if you can mark both the options, if there is a possibility that two options can be marked, both would be correct. Most appropriate management of OP position in labor, either caesarean section, wait and watch for progress of labor, early rupture of membrane, or oxytocin drip. Caesarean section, OP position, there can be delivery, so caesarean section is not an option. Early rupture of membrane, not necessarily. Oxytocin drip, only in presence of, if there are no good contractions, then only we want to enhance it by giving oxytocin. So, just because the head is deflated in OP position, engagement gets delayed, the further progress of labor would be delayed. So, wait and watch for the progress of labor would be the right answer. We have to be a little patient, watch for the progress, and if absolutely there is no progress, then we can go ahead. Now, we said that if there is short anterior rotation, there can be arrest, that is deep transverse arrest. But this has a definition. So, what is by definition, what is deep transverse arrest? The cervix is fully dilated, membranes are gone, there are good uterine contractions, the head is at the level of ischial spine, the sutures are in transverse diameter, and with good uterine contractions, we wait for almost half an hour to 1 hour. But if there is no rotation and no descent, then this situation is called as deep transverse arrest. I repeat myself that the os is fully dilated, cervix is fully dilated, membranes absent, the head is deep inside the pelvis at the level of the ischial spine, that means at zero station, sutures are placed transversely. With good uterine contractions, we wait for half an hour to 1 hour, but if the head fails to rotate or there is no descent, then we call it as deep transverse arrest. The sutures are at the level of bispinous diameter and transversely placed. The causes can be disproportion, that is CPD. There can be severe deflection where there is something which is avoiding flexion of the head, weak uterine contractions, or lax pelvic floor which is not actually offering any resistance, which is a basis for flexion to take place. What should be the treatment modality? If we feel that the baby is big size and there is a problem, we can go for caesarean section in this particular case, or before that we would like to try manual rotation and then forceps application. Ventus can be applied. Ventus can give us both the advantages, like rotation can be caused and extraction. Forceps rotation used to be done with Keelan's forceps, mid-cavity forceps application, rotation, and then. But in modern obstetrics, outlet forceps are recommended. We don't really use higher forceps than that. But still, your books mention all these modalities for treatment. Let's solve a MCQ. Again, on DTA. In DTA, delivery of baby is conducted by cesarean section, vacuum extraction, Keelan's forceps, manual rotation and forceps delivery. If you have to pick only one good or one best option, then I would suggest cesarean section is the best answer because it is deep transverse arrest. But if you are permitted to mark more than one options, then all the above, they become the right answer. Now after OP position, the other common malpresentation. OP position was a kind of malposition where the presentation is still cephalic but little deflex head, so it becomes malposition. Now we are talking about malpresentation, and the most common is breech. Mind well, student, breech is a favorite of examiner and there are many MCQs on breech. So let's just revise it. Incidence is almost 3 to 4% in general population at term. Mind well, at term the incidence of breech is low, but before term or prematurely, like at 28 weeks, 32 weeks, the chances of having breech is very high. Because as the baby is growing, cephalic presentation is at the end of the third term because the head becomes heavy and gravity acts, and that is how the preferred position of the baby is cephalic. But when head has during like growth around 28, 30 weeks, 32 weeks, there is no such action, and that is why usually the baby is in breech presentation. So if the patient goes in preterm labor, prematurity at that particular time, breech is the most favored or most commonly observed presentation. Alteration in maternal and fetal ovoid causes breech. So this ovoid, if there is alteration, then that leads to breech. What are the other common causes? As I told you that physiologically before term, breech is the presentation. So then as the term nears, then it gets, there is virgin which causes cephalic presentation. So anything which avoids this will lead to permanent breech presentation. Like if the lichen is less, or if there is tumor like fibroid which doesn't allow the position of the baby to change, or if the placenta previa, if there is placenta in the lower segment which will not allow, or congenital anomaly of the uterus which will not allow the baby to turn, or maybe multiple gestation because of overcrowding, two babies, so baby will not be able to change its position, short cord. So now if you think this way, that the reason is that the baby's position cannot be changed, so you will remember one by one what are the reasons where this will happen. Or sometimes baby's head is big, like in hydrocephalus, that will cause permanent breech position rather than having vertex presentation or cephalic presentation. So let's just revise the causes, because again it's most commonly asked question on these. Most common cause of breech is prematurity. Always remember, most common cause of breech presentation is seen in prematurity. Other causes are fundal insertion of placenta, short cord, uterine anomalies like septate and biconoid uterus, polyhydramnios, multiparity. In these two things, there is excessive movement of the baby. Lichen is more, multiparity lacks abdominal wall, baby keeps turning, and thus breech presentation may be there. Twins, hydrocephalus. So these are few important causes of breech presentation. Now what are the types of breech? Types will be either complete breech or incomplete breech. Complete breech means in which the thighs are flexed, knees are flexed, and the presenting part is both the buttocks along with the feet. This is complete breech. Flexed attitude of the fetus. There is no extension at any of these joints. Most commonly seen in multipara, MCQ. What is complete breech? There would be flexion or extension at different joints is asked. Seen in multi or primi, it's commonly seen in multigravidas. Now coming to incomplete breech, it can be seen in three different types. Frank, the other name of which is extended breech. In this, there is flexion at the thigh and there is extension at the knee joint. So the limbs, lower limbs are extended, flexed at the thigh, flexed at the thigh and extended at the knee. This position is commonly seen in primate gravidas because good muscle tone, and that's why frank or extended breech is seen in primate gravidas. Knee presentation, here there is extension at the thigh level and there is flexion at the knee joint. So the knees are the presenting part. In footling, there would be little extension at the thigh and little extension at the knee as well. So feet will be the presenting part, and this is a condition where cesarean section is recommended because footling and knee, they cannot really have that ball and valve kind of action, and that is why cord prolapse is more commonly seen in these, because if the os dilates and these presentation, cord can anyway come out and get prolapsed, and that is why cesarean section is recommended. In complete and frank breech, we can always have vaginal trial depending on that particular baby size, all those factors which we are going to see later. How to diagnose? Per abdomen, you will be seeing that on fundal grip, head would be felt, hard, globular, ballotable structure, that is the head is felt per abdominally at the fundal grip. Lower grip, you will feel that soft, quadrangular structure which is non-ballotable, suggestive of fetal breech. Back is on one side, limbs are on the other side. FHS usually above the umbilical level. On PV examination, depending on the type of the breech, you will see the findings. In complete breech, buttocks and limbs. In frank breech, only the buttock. So both the ischial tuberosity and the anal opening in between. We may get confused whether it is face presentation or it is breech, because even in face, we see two bony prominences and one opening. But if you see the relation, they form a triangle. And in frank breech, the two bony prominences and the anal opening will have one, they are in one single line. Again, if you put finger in that opening, if there is suckling action, you are having mouth as a, that is the face presentation. If there is no suckling, you are having your finger in the anal opening. And again, if you see presence of meconium on your tip of the finger, that confirms that this is a frank breech and not face presentation. This usually you have to differentiate this when the patient comes in labor, membranes are gone, there is caput or the tissue becomes edematous, then these kind of problems you may face. Ultrasound confirms the diagnosis as well as gives you fair idea that how is the baby, how is the baby's attitude, whether the baby is in flexion or the baby is in extension, what is approximate expected birth weight of the baby, because that is very important when we are making a decision whether this patient should be allowed for vaginal delivery or cesarean section. So ultrasound confirms the diagnosis, gives us information about the attitude, the expected weight, placental position, Liker status, neck, whether it is extended flex, whether there is presence of loops of cord around neck or any swelling like goiter or bronchocele, where the delivery of after coming head would be difficult. So all these informations we get on ultrasound. X-rays which were done previously, the stargazing look and attitude of extension were the contraindications for vaginal delivery. There is one score that is called a Giacuzzini-Andrews score. They consider few parameters which are important in decision making whether that particular patient is to be delivered vaginally or by cesarean section. And the parameters are parity. Vaginal delivery is preferred in multipara than in primi because of muscle tone and the laxity of the pelvic floor. Gestational age. In preterm breech, we would like to do cesarean section more than a term. Estimated fetal weight. If the fetal weight is less than 2 kg or more than 3.5 kg, cesarean section is preferred over vaginal delivery. Previous breech delivery, if the mother gives history that she has delivered one breech baby which was more than 2.5 kgs, then it adds to, or we favor her to deliver vaginally because of this prior history. And again, cervical dilatation and station of the head on admission, they add. If the cervix is favorable, station is low, then we would have more points in favor of vaginal delivery. Now let's understand on Levi's mechanism of labor in breech delivery. The mechanism takes place at three levels. One at the buttocks, where the diameter of the engaging diameter is bitrochanteric 10 cm. Then at shoulder level, where the engaging diameter is bisacromial, which is 12 cm. And then the aftercoming head, where the engaging diameter is suboccipitofrontal, that is 10 cm. Now in breech, the most favored position is sacroanterior, and that also right sacro or left sacro. Left sacroanterior is more commonly seen than right sacroanterior. Sacroanterior is preferred. How the labor progresses? Engaging diameter is first bitrochanteric, the buttocks get engaged. Diameter of engagement is the oblique diameter. As soon as the anterior buttock touches the levatorani, that is the denominator, it gets shifted towards the pubic symphysis. So rotation through 1/8 of the circle from the oblique to anteroposterior. Then the anterior breech hinges below the pubic symphysis, or we can call it as ascent of breech, climbing of the breech. The way we say crowning of head, here we say climbing of the breech. So the anterior breech followed by a posterior breech, then both the legs get delivered. There is restitution again through 1/8 of the circle. Labor progresses, then shoulder gets engaged. What is the diameter, engaging diameter? That is bisacromial. Once the anterior shoulder touches the levatorani, that gets rotated and comes in lie in the anteroposterior diameter. Then there is delivery of shoulder, posterior anterior shoulder gets delivered. Then the head gets engaged in the opposite oblique diameter. Engaging diameter is suboccipitofrontal. As there is progress, the occiput touches the levatorani, it gets rotated through 1/8 of the circle, and that would be seen as externally will also be seen because of rotation of the occiput. And now the baby is placed in transverse diameter. Then the head gets engaged, gradually there is descent, and head gets delivered by flexion. Please remember, in breech the head gets delivered by flexion. Once the head comes out, there would be again the other movements would be the rest of the body and rest of the afterbirths will follow. Type of breech deliveries: there is spontaneous breech delivery, assisted breech delivery, and breech extraction. In spontaneous, no mechanism is seen. Baby is usually seen in preterm, the baby just gets expelled out. In assisted breech, we need some support or some kind of assistant to be given, from keeping the anesthesia facilities ready to having an assistant which will keep, which will give suprapubic pressure if required. We should avoid pulling of the baby. Then waiting and having patience would really matter in case of breech delivery. So here we are assisting the breech delivery, and in breech extraction, we have to literally extract the baby out. That is breech extraction. There can be arrest of breech when breech is getting delivered. Arrest of buttock can happen at three levels, that is at the bream, at the mid pelvis, or at the outlet. Arrest of shoulders can occur at bream, and arrest of aftercoming head also can occur at bream, mid pelvis, and outlet. Now, there are different arrests, and we have to have some mechanisms. Basically, let's concentrate on aftercoming head. Aftercoming head has certain disadvantages, that usually in vertex presentation, head gets time to get engaged, then gradually there is molding, and then gradually there is descent and baby comes out. But in breech, rest of the body has delivered. So head gets very less time to go through these processes. So there is compression and sudden decompression, which makes the baby very much prone for intracerebral hemorrhage. There can be asphyxia if there is cord prolapse, or just because the baby's body is hanging outside, there may be premature attempts to respire, and because of these things, baby's morbidity is increased. Now these, to deliver the aftercoming head, we have certain methods. Please remember the names: Burns-Marshall method, or forceps delivery of aftercoming head, or Marichu smelly wet method. These were three gynecologists together, and they developed this method. In Burns Marshall, once the baby's nape of the neck is seen and delivery takes place till there, then we hold baby's legs at the ankle, and by giving downward and forward traction, just by forming a wide arc of circle, we deliver the baby. This is one technique. Forceps can be applied to deliver the aftercoming head, where the forceps act as a cage and deliver the baby so that the compression and decompression effect can be avoided. And Marichu smelly wet, in which left hand is supinated, kept under the baby. The index finger and middle finger are kept on the malar prominences, and they cause flexion. Suprapubic pressure is given so that flexion is maintained. The other hand, the right hand, one finger, index finger is on one shoulder, the rest of the fingers on the other shoulder. One middle finger is on the nape of the neck, and that gives shoulder. So flexion and then shoulder traction is the method in Marichu smelly wet by which we deliver the aftercoming head. So these were the methods to deliver the aftercoming head in breech. We'll stop here and then we'll solve some MCQs for revision of breech, and also see if there are extended arms or legs, how to deliver them by which maneuvers. So let's stop here. Thank you.